Welcome friends to EPG Patashala. I am Dr. N. Janardana, working as additional professor in the Department of Psychiatric Social Work, NIMHANS, Bangalore. Today, let us learn about common mental disorders. In my previous module, I ended up talking about classification of mental disorder, where common mental disorder was one part of the triangle, which was the line was written and then striked out. If you remember the normal population have more chances to get common mental disorder, and once like the disorder is being cured, we would again become as a normal population. So common mental disorder are more prevalent among general population. Patient experience subjective distress due to presence of a symptom or a group of symptoms. And most of these common mental disorders are related to stress-related disorders. The symptom is recognized as undesirable and they have insight about their problem. They know that they are not feeling well, they are depressed, they have anxiety problem. The symptom will be recognized and that insight will be there, whereas in severe mental disorder, the insight would be absent. So common mental disorder people would recognize that there is some problem in them and that need to be treated. The personality, behavior and contact with reality are always maintained. The person will be able to maintain the day-to-day functioning, what he or she is supposed to do, but only thing they may delay in performing certain things. Their behavior and contact with their significant other people would be maintained and they are reality oriented. Common mental disorder are classified as neurotic stress related and somatoform disorder in ICD-10. Now let us learn about the classification of common mental disorders. One is anxiety disorder. Mainly we have two types of disorder. One is anxiety disorder, another one is a depression. So in anxiety disorder, it is characterized by a state of apprehension or unease arising out of anticipation of danger. Normal anxiety becomes pathological when the intensity of the symptom is out of proportion to precipitating factor and duration is more than what is usually expected. Symptoms are causing impairment with his day-to-day functioning and is not the patient's habitual pattern of reaction to stressful situation. To give an example, it's normal to have an anxiety before writing an examination, and that anxiety would be there until that exam is getting over. Once the exam gets over, the anxiety also would disappear. Again, the anxiety would come back one day before the results. And immediately after results, the anxiety again would go back. To diagnose a person is having anxiety, the symptoms need to be persistent for a quite long period of time, minimum of 20 days to 1 month. The symptoms should be persistent, which should be different from the premorbid personality. And the symptoms should cause impairment in his day-to-day functioning. And it should be different from the habitual reaction to stressful situation. So how it would affect his day-to-day functioning when a person with an anxiety symptom is not able to perform any of the tasks what he or she is expected. If she is expected to cook at home and as a homemaker, cook at home, take care of husband and children. If she is unable to perform such roles because of her anxiety, then it will be diagnosed as an illness. Otherwise, we all do experience some form of anxiety in our day-to-day functioning that cannot be diagnosed as an illness. It's related to the activity what we are supposed to perform. It's normal to have anxiety when we have to make a presentation. And because of that anxiety, we also would prepare well. And anxiety has both positive and the negative side also. Sometimes anxiety can help us in preparing better in exams. And sometimes anxiety can create problem and it may affect in terms of our performance in the exam. So common mental disorders can be classified broadly into two type of illnesses, where is anxiety and depression. And we have other subcategories like dissociative disorder, reaction to severe stress, which can lead to adjustment problem, and somatoform disorder. These are commonly seen among general population. Various research studies have been confirmed that 30% of the people who approach to general practitioners or to a PSC doctor would require mental health intervention, and most of these symptoms are related to common mental disorder. They have been treated with repeated painkillers, and people tend to shop doctors in order to find solutions to their problem. If proper mental health intervention being provided at that time, shopping of the doctors can be reduced and the person also can be relieved from the problems. Now let us understand the symptoms of anxiety. There are two broad categories of symptoms, which are physical symptoms and psychological symptoms. The physical symptoms would be chest pain and palpitation. The palpitation means high heart rate, chills and excessive sweating, dizziness, unsteadiness, lightheadedness, fainting spells, rapid breathing, the difficulty in breathing, choking sensation, tremors, trembling or shaking, nausea, abdominal discomfort, diarrhea, urinary urgency and frequency, body aches and pain, restlessness, fidgetiness, rise in blood pressure. These are some of the physical symptoms where the person would experience. And there are some psychological symptoms like agitation feeling, keyed up or feeling in the edge or tensed, difficulty in concentrating, mind going blank, excessive concern, worries, apprehension, easy irritability, easy fatigability, excessive thinking, fear of loss control or going crazy, fear of dying, feeling of being detached from oneself, difficulty in falling asleep. These are some of the psychological symptoms. If you have to just understand what would be the symptom of anxiety, just imagine yourself when you are inside the room, suddenly you would see a snake coming inside the room. The fearness what you would experience, that time you would experience high palpitation and excessive fearfulness and sometimes excessive sweating would be there, tremors would be, you would have experienced. Because of the thought of snake coming and harming us, so we would experience all these symptoms which are similar to that of an anxiety symptoms. Now let us understand the types of anxiety disorder. There are generalized anxiety disorder, then panic disorders and phobic disorders. Generalized anxiety disorder are excessive anxiety and worry about negative outcomes, about various events and activities. In case if I have to make a presentation today, because of my generalized anxiety disorder, always I would think about negative outcomes and I may not be able to perform my presentation, and I would ask for postponements, saying that I am yet to be prepared for the presentation. So it would affect my day-to-day functioning in case if I am having a generalized anxiety disorder. The next type of anxiety disorder is panic disorder, where it's the spontaneous of out of blue character of panic attacks. It will be like an attack where the stress would be converted into an attack. Whenever the person is exposed to a stress, it would end up having a panic disorder. Then we have the third category as phobic disorders. Under phobic disorders, it can be various types of phobia. Commonly seen phobias are specific phobia, agoraphobia and social phobia. In specific phobia, we would have seen people who are scared of either cockroaches. Sometimes we have seen people who get fainted by looking at the color of a blood. And sometimes we would have seen people getting scared of a lizard and making a huge sound whenever they see a lizard. So all this would fall under the specific type of phobia. Some people are also having a fear of heights. So whenever they climb the stairs, they would feel panic attacks or anxiety would come, and then it will be difficult for them to handle the situation. Then we have agoraphobia, where a person is afraid of getting into a situation which would create more anxiety, so he would end up avoiding the situation. Then we have social phobia, where person would find it difficult to get into a social situation where he would be fearful of getting exposed and he would try to avoid the situations. Sometimes people would have seen people may not be greeting people when they have a visitors at home, or try to avoid visitors because of this anxiety problem. So for the in order to deal with this anxiety, there are a lot of psychosocial interventions which can be initiated. Medicines only would help us to up to certain level, and it is a psychosocial intervention which would help the individual to take control over his life situation and to take control over his fearful situation, so that the person will be able to deal with the situation. Insight-oriented psychotherapy is one of the intervention which would help the patients to understand their situation, that is the hypothesized unconscious meaning of the anxiety. They will be able to understand. They would know that it's the fearful what they have is unrealistic, and they need to overcome, as they have a good insight about their problem. Once we build insight and deal with their cognitions, they will be able to come out of this anxiety. Then supportive psychotherapy, it will help the patient to actively confront to anxiety situation or object during treatment. So that also plays a very major role in helping the persons to overcome their anxiety. Then we have behavior therapy, where exposure therapy and systematic desensitization, graded exposure and flooding being tried. In systematic desensitization, a person who would approach a therapist for an example of fearful of seeing a cockroach. So the graded exposure need to be done, where systematic desensitization would be done. Initially, the therapist would talk about cockroach, and then the client would be feeling the fearfulness. The level of fearfulness would get reduced over a period of time. Then a cockroach, a cartoon of a cockroach is exposed, or a container which has a cockroach been painted on that container would be kept in one corner of the room, and the person will be allowed to sit here and talk about it, talk about the fearfulness. Then slowly the container would be brought nearer to the client, so that the anxiety levels also would get reduced over a period of time. This we call it as desensitization and a graded exposure. Flooding is something where the client will be allowed to touch certain things which was fearful to that person, so that it will be able to for him to overcome the anxiety associated with certain objects. Then we have cognitive behavior therapy, which reinforces the realization, and it will help in terms of altering our cognitions, so that the anxiety levels also would get reduced. Then we have family therapy, where involvement of family in the treatment, so that they will be able to understand the nature of the client's problem. If family is not able to understand, then the family would put pressure on the person, and in that pressure would increase further anxiety. So family intervention play a major role, so that psychoeducation would be provided to the family, and they would create a favorable atmosphere within the family, so that the person will be able to overcome the problem. Now let us look in terms of the second common type of a common mental disorder, which is called depression. This is one of the most frequently occurring mental illness, which affects people of all ages. The lifetime prevalence of depression has been found to be 15.3%. The clinical features would be sadness of mood, loss of energy, loss of interest in almost all pleasurable activities, feeling guilt, significant loss of appetite and sleep disturbances, decreased ability to think or concentrate, or indecisiveness or forgetfulness, then psychomotor retardation or agitation. These are some of the common clinical features which we would see in depression. Now let us understand the causes of depression. It's a result of a genetic, biological and psychological combined with life stresses. In previous sessions, we have understood in terms of the causes of mental illness, where a genetic also play a role, and the chemical imbalance in the brain, and combined with psychological and life stresses, which would result into depression. So disturbance of brain biochemistry, irregularities in specific brain chemicals are important factors in depression. Difficult life events such as problem relationship, financial difficulties or loss of a loved one. Sometimes depression is also associated with a general medical illness. Whenever the person is having a chronic health condition, chances of person getting into depression is going to be more, and depression is also going to be a process through which the person would start accepting his condition. Now let us understand the types of depression. The first type of depression is major depressive disorder, which disrupts person's mood, behavior, thought process and physical health, and it's going to be for a persistent for a longer period of time. And then we have dysthymia. These symptoms are milder but long lasting. A person with dysthymia feel distressed and have significant disability in the long term. The symptoms are in milder, but they are long lasting. In various degrees they would experience these symptoms. And person with dysthymia feel distressed and feel significant disability in their day-to-day functioning, which would be for a longer period of time. Usually we diagnose person with dysthymia when the symptoms are persistent for more than 1 year continuously, without the person is able to come back, or without getting into pre-morbid level of functioning or under the remission phase. The third category of type of depression is depression of postpartum onset. About half of all new mothers may feel mildly depressed, anxious, tense or unwell during the time of pregnancy. And mother with this illness find it increasingly difficult to cope with the demand of everyday life. Increasingly find it difficult to cope with the demand of feeding the child, taking care of a child. And because of the depression, the relationship between the mother and the child also can get affected. Let us understand now the management of depression. As usual for all mental illness, for depression also there have been pharmacotherapy, where antidepressant medication helps the person to overcome depression. Along with antidepressant medication, sometimes we would try with electroconvulsive therapy as an add-on treatment. When antidepressants are not giving the results what we are expected, so then the electroconvulsive therapy would be tried out. And sometimes electroconvulsive therapy can also do wonders for person with depression. Then we have psychotherapy, where interpersonal therapy, behavioral therapy, cognitive behavioral therapy, marital, family and group therapy have been found effective as management for depression. One thing we have to keep in mind, the medicines may help us in terms of 50% for the person to overcome the depression. The other psychosocial interventions, if added with the pharmacotherapy, then the person will be able to recover fast and take control over this life situation. Now let us understand the third form of common mental disorder, that is somatoform disorder, where it has been characterized by repeated presentation of physical symptoms which do not have an adequate physical basis, and a persistent request for investigation and treatment despite repeated assurances by the treating doctors. The commonly seen problem, this is more commonly seen among middle-aged and little elderly women, where they would repeatedly keep complaining about either knee pain or low back pain, and investigations whatever been carried out, everything seems to be normal, but still the pain would be persistent. Sometimes we may have a doubt whether this is, are they people projecting themselves or acting. But to answer to this question, I would say like people are not acting. The stresses have been converted into a physical symptom where they really would experience the physical symptom. If we start treating with the painkiller, the pain would disappear, again the pain would come back. To give an example how mind and body are related, so imagine yourself, you are on the main road, a busy main road where traffic have been quite heavy. You would notice a child crossing the road and there were a truck coming on the other side. As per your judgment, you would feel that this truck is going to come and hit the child, and accident is going to happen in front of you, even though you don't want to see such an accident, but you are in a helpless situation where accident would happen in front of you. And you are also not in a position to go and pull back the child. If you try to attempt that, you may end up getting into an accident. At that point of time, you would experience some physical symptoms, like tremors would be there, mouth will get dry. Even though if you are making a sound, the sound may not come out. High palpitation would have been noticed, sweating. All these symptoms would have been seen. At that particular point of time, you would not have any physical symptom or physiological disorder, which most of these symptoms are related to cardiac related symptom, but at that particular point of time you may not have any cardiac problem, but still you would experience such symptoms. So why does such symptoms would occur? The thought of seeing an accident which you are not comfortable in front of you may give a reaction in terms of the physiological reaction, like in terms of tremors, mouth getting dry, sound not coming out, sometimes getting faint, hairs would stand. So all the physiological symptoms you would see, the thought being converted into a physiological symptom. Similarly here the stresses would get converted into a physiological symptom which need to be understood. Just doing an repeated investigation and giving assurance to the person may not be able to understand. Unless we deal with the stress, the physiological symptom would not disappear. Now let us understand the types of somatic problem, somatization and hypochondriasis. In somatization, there are multiple somatic symptoms in the absence of any physical disorder, chronic and recurrent symptoms. Doctor shopping is quite common in somatization. They refuse to listen to the advice or reassurance from the doctors. An impairment in social and family functioning is seen in people who have somatization disorder. Hypochondriasis, persistent preoccupation with the fear of having one or more serious disease based on person's own interpretation of normal body function or a minor physical abnormality. To give an example, recently I have seen a client who had skin rashes, but immediately this client started thinking that he may have some type of cancer and went for all investigation and it tend to be normal. Then the person was satisfied. So sometimes small things also we'll try to put it as a negative thing and wanted to go for investigations and get cured. Finally the diagnosis for this person, they made it as skin related problems, and it was treated for that problem. So there are people who tend to think negatively, small symptoms being put as something serious medical condition or a serious psychiatric condition, and they want to go for treatment and do all the investigation, and once the investigation turned out to be normal, then only they will be able to satisfy it. So this is also one type of somatic problem. Let us understand now the dissociative disorder. So this is another type of common mental disorder, usually seen more in school children, and also in women this disorder prevalence rate is more compared to men. This is characterized by disturbance in the normal integrated function of identity, consciousness, memory. It has a sudden onset and a temporary disturbance. Always there will be a precipitating stressor, and always there will be a secondary gain, and symptom cannot be explained by investigation. To give an example about a dissociative disorder, we have been seeing some children who experience some difficulties in the school. Either it may be the class teacher is too strict, or the child will have problem in terms of performing mathematics, or the child is not feeling comfortable when the child is being changed to a new school. So the stressor would get converted into a physical symptom. In order to as child will not be able to explain the stresses due to lack of language ability, the stress would be converted into physiological symptom, where the child would start avoiding go to school. Immediately in the morning when the child has to get ready to the school, child may throw with an seizure. It will be like an epileptic fits. But only difference in this fit is going to occur only when people are around, and always it will be in a place where it is safe. The child may not get hurt. So either that when child is sitting on a sofa or sitting on the on the bed, the child would get an attack, and child would be conscious during the attack. When asked questions, child would be able to answer, and later the child may say that I don't remember anything. So if you have to deal with this stress, first we need to understand the problem what the child is facing at the school. Unless we understand that stress and deal with the stress, the physiological symptom may not be removed. As I said previously, the mind and body has been closely connected. whatever we think, it will be affected in our body. In this child, the stresses in the school is their cognitive cognitions, which get affect to, which has been shown as a epileptic fit, but it's not a real fit. Again, the child is not acting, it is the stresses are getting converted into a physical symptom. Another common dissociative attack what we see in women, particularly in families where it's a weaving community, where women are expected to work, take care of household responsibilities, at the same time able to supply material for the husband who weaves, in terms of getting the silk thread ready. So the woman would have lot of responsibilities. When the woman could not cope up with those responsibilities, chances of getting dissociative attacks are going to be more in such families. Now let us understand the etiology of obsessive etiology of dissociative disorder. Like defense mechanisms are used during stresses. Everyone uses a different type of defense mechanisms. Sometimes the defense mechanisms can be faulty, which can lead to as a cause for the dissociative disorder. There are subtypes of dissociative disorder: dissociative amnesia, dissociative fugue and multiple personality disorder, trance and possession disorder. Always we would have seen people in the community saying that I have been possessed by an evil spirit or possessed by a god, and people would ask questions whether such possession is possible. When such questions are asked to me, I would ask back questions back to them, asking them, do you think the possession is more in men or women? Then the answer would, what I would get is, it will be more in women. Then if you look in terms of the gods, different types of gods getting possessed, is it like gods like Rama, Krishna, Shiva get possessed more, or is it like Yellamma, Maramma who get possessed more? So the answer would be, most of the time it will be the Maramma or Yellamma who would possess. We have not seen people like saying that I have been possessed by either Vishnu, Shiva. Like that, it's always, it will be the lady gods who get possessed. Then if you look in terms of ask a question, the socio-economic status, they would say it's more in the low socio-economic status, very less in high socio-economic status. Then if you ask in terms of the caste, whether it's in more upper like higher caste or in the lower caste, again the answer would be in the lower caste. Then I would leave for the answer to be told by that people, because I have asked questions, let them come to conclusion. Is it like God need to be possessed for all socioeconomic status? It's not just with lower socioeconomic status, and God need to be possessed with all type of gods need to get possessed, but it will be always the local village gods who would get possessed more, and it will be more in women compared to men. So now people need to answer whether it's a real possession or is it a form of a disorder which can be cured. Is it because of stress people would get possessed? So this you need to answer yourself. Now let us look into some of the management. Management of dissociative disorder, where it's mainly behavioral therapy, attempt to reduce attention seeking, sick role and secondary gain, normalizing day-to-day routine in another is another focus. Like the case what I had explained earlier, a child having a dissociative fits. So as a therapist, what we need to do, we need to cut down the secondary gains what the child has been getting it. Like whenever the child gets an attack, everyone would surround him and started treating and giving more attention. That attention need to be cut down first. So we need to explain the family, there is no need to give attention. Instead of giving attention, we should say to the child that nothing wrong has happened. Now you can go back to school, and need to intervene at the school level so that the fear, whatever the child been carrying out, that can be reduced. Supportive psychotherapy is also need to be addressed for the child, so that the child will be able to deal with the conflicts what he has been facing and overcome such conflicts so that he can go back and lead a normal life. Now, let us learn about another common mental disorder, which are like reaction to severe stress and adjustment disorder. Whenever we are exposed to severe form of stress, it may lead to adjustment problem. So, in adjustment disorder, development of emotional or behavioral symptom in response to an identifiable stressor occurring within a month of the onset of the stress, and the duration of symptom usually does not exceed for more than 6 months. When we are put to a new situation, we do experience adjustment problem. Sometimes we will be able to cope with those adjustment situation. Sometimes we may find it difficult. It may lead into an adjustment disorder. There is another condition called grief and bereavement. Bereavement is a loss of loved person through death. It's quite normal to be depressed when we lose a loved person. And this depression over a period of time should get reduced. If it is not getting reduced and affecting our day-to-day functioning, then we would get into the diagnosis of adjustment disorder. So with this, we have now completed common mental illness. So where we have looked in terms of the prevalence of common mental disorder, how common it is in general population. We have looked at types of common mental disorder, where we have understood anxiety, depression, then somatization, then we have understood dissociative disorder, then adjustment disorder, which are very commonly seen among people. And in our day-to-day experience, we would have come across people who are having such problems, and most of them would have not approached to a mental health doctor. They would prefer to go to a general practitioner because of the stigma attached towards it. They like to get treated with a general practitioner and then shop doctors, not finding solution to the problem. So there is an urgent need in terms of creating awareness about common mental illness. Once people are identified and treated, their quality of life can be enhanced. So it's our responsibility to identify such people, talk to them, and help them to understand that mental health means it's not just severe mental illness alone, it's also common mental illness, which are most commonly seen. If they identify themselves and recognize the symptoms, it's always better to get treated. And there has been treatment for all these problems, both the pharmacological intervention and counseling and psychological interventions would definitely help the clients to overcome their problems and lead a happy and good quality of life. Thank you all.